If you pay attention to American politics, you have surely by now heard the name Brett Kavanaugh. Kavanaugh is the next Supreme Court justice. He's going to replace Anthony Kennedy. It's going to happen, and there's really nothing that Senate Democrats...
42,000 pages of documents that we have not had an opportunity to review or read or analyze.
You're out of order. I'll proceed.
Mr. Chairman, I agree with my colleague, Senator Harris. Mr. Chairman,
Judge
we
Kavanaugh
received 42,000 documents...
Or screeching protesters... can do about that at this point. Am I thrilled about this? No. There's nothing in Kavanaugh's record that strikes me as exemplary or truly special. He doesn't have that bombastic flair of an Antonin Scalia or the radical jurisprudence of a Robert Bork, but he's a decent conservative justice with a pretty typical set of opinions. He's going to rule in favor of the Second Amendment like he has in the past, and in favor of freedom of association. He won't force you to bake the cake, but I'm not sure where he would come down on newer issues like tech censorship and access to the digital public square. This isn't going to be a video about Kavanaugh's judicial record or how I think he'll perform on the court. I don't have much to say about his record aside from that it's good, not great, but good. There have been several deep dives into his record performed by others out there, and I'll link to a few analyses below that I found informative. Instead, this video will focus on the shenanigans and craziness surrounding Kavanaugh's appointment. I thought the protests in the second week of September were insane, but over the past few days, we've seen things get ratcheted up to an 11. Two storylines have now converged, #MeToo and the Supreme Court nomination process, and you and I are just along for this wild ride. We'll dig into the Brett Kavanaugh accusations and discuss how clearly false they are. We'll discuss if they even matter. That will tie into the topic of the Democratic desperation to stop Kavanaugh's nomination. And then we'll get to the topic of just why they're so insistent on blocking his nomination, even though he's not a far-right radical or anything of the sort. But before we do that, let's talk about your online privacy and security. With all of the talk about internet corporate tyranny and threats to your privacy, there's no reason not to get you and your family protected by a VPN, or virtual private network. Just last month, T-Mobile, one of America's largest cell phone providers, was hacked, and the personal information of up to 2 million customers may have been stolen. This is just further rationale for why you need to protect yourself when doing business online. If you're using the internet unprotected, you are putting your personal and financial data at risk. And before you say, oh, I'm safe, I use a free VPN, not so fast. Free VPNs make their money by logging and selling your personal data, totally defeating the point of using a VPN. Just last month, Facebook's free mobile VPN was banned from Apple's App Store for collecting private data. You need to stay safe. That's why I recommend using Virtual Shield, the world's fastest and easiest to use VPN. They have a strict no-log policy, meaning that none of your data is stored, protecting you from data breaches and hackers. Right now is their summer blowout sale, where you can get their plans for 70% off, including their additional Identisafe mic and camera blocking technology. VirtualShield.com/AllSub. Check them out today and get protected. They're the company that I trust. All right, so as you know, Justice Anthony Kennedy is retiring from the Supreme Court, and Trump nominated Brett Kavanaugh, a current circuit judge, on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. When judges issue rulings on cases, the attached legal analysis is referred to as an opinion. These opinions become public record, so Kavanaugh's legal track record, as it were, is available for the public to see. He hasn't made any obscene, improper, or horrible rulings. In less partisan times, Kavanaugh is the type of middle-of-the-road, conservative-leaning judge that would be nominated by a 98-2 vote with limited drama and consternation. But we no longer live in times like that. We'd live in clown world. And so, less than a week before the September 20th Judiciary Committee vote on Kavanaugh's confirmation, the left has decided to dig into their war chest and pull out the weapon they have tried to wield against almost every prominent Republican candidate they oppose. Accusations of sexual impropriety. Flashback to the 2016 race, where, just a week before the election, women came out of the woodwork to claim that Trump had, 30 years ago, touched them inappropriately in some way. Of course, many of these women ended up having some left-wing politics in their past, and none of their cases were ever proven. They were all just baseless accusations with political motivation. It's a sign of societal breakdown and the country splitting in two when it is now acceptable to resort to false accusations of sexual impropriety in order to get what you want politically. That's not something that happens in serious countries. That's something that only happens in countries being held together by duct tape, platitudes, and willful ignorance. Anyways, this playbook is being predictably used against Kavanaugh. Imagine my shock. In this case, the accuser is a woman named Christine Blasey Ford, a professor at Palo Alto University. She alleges that during a house party in 1982, when she was 15 and Kavanaugh was 17, he got on top of her in a bedroom at a party. He kissed her and tried to get her undressed, which he failed to do, and that was about it. No penetration of anything into anywhere, no contact beneath the clothing, that's what happened. She then left the party and went home, according to her story. And that's the scandalous story they're going with. Apparently, she told a couples therapist about this in 2012, although the notes that apparently implicate Kavanaugh don't name him by name and have not been made available to the public. Although, according to her husband, she did name him by name during the sessions, and she expressed concern that he one day might be nominated to the Supreme Court. Yeah, I'm sure she did, pal. This, of course, begs several questions. Number one, according to the husband, she knew Kavanaugh's name and that this 1982 incident apparently happened all the way back in 2012. Why didn't she say anything then in 2012 when she recalled this to her therapist and husband? Or why didn't she say anything earlier before 2012? I mean, this happened in 1982. She's apparently known about this for all these years, but it's now just coming forward. That doesn't make sense. If you really wanted justice to be done, you would come forward as soon as possible. Unless, of course, you were waiting, as her husband mentioned in that interview, for him to be nominated to the Supreme Court, and you're holding on to this as political ammunition. So that's suspicious. Number two, how do we know this even happened? Well, we don't. Kavanaugh denies it took place. In situations like this, you want evidence. No, you need evidence before you completely and irreparably destroy someone's life and career over accusations. Accusations are not evidence, much to the chagrin of the foaming at the mouth left that would love nothing more than to see Donald Trump and Kavanaugh thrown in prison over the fever dreams of postmenopause leftist activist women. By the way, the one witness that supposedly saw this denies that it ever took place. He's claimed that since her interviews have been made public. So, bad news for her story. And finally, number three. Even if this were true, does that mean that Kavanaugh shouldn't join the Supreme Court? We've known for a while now that our legal system discriminates against men in things like divorce courts, protection orders, child custody battles, etc. But we're also moving now in a direction that should be alarming for men in this country, especially young men. We're moving towards the outright criminalization of normal male behavior. I'm not saying that what Kavanaugh was accused of is normal or okay. In fact, in most places, it would constitute sexual assault. But let's go beyond the Kavanaugh case for a moment. With the proliferation of sexual assault accusations over the past few years, I think we need to be very careful when we talk about what constitutes actual sexual assault. For example, if you're talking to a girl at a party, she's giving off signs that she's into you, and you think things are going well, so you move in and kiss her. That's an entirely normal thing to happen. It happens hundreds, if not thousands, if not dozens of thousands of times every single day. That's how human sexual dynamics have worked for thousands of years. Communications happens, but it isn't entirely verbal. It's more than that. It's body language, facial expression, tone of voice, and so much more. But nowadays, if you kiss a girl without first asking, hello, miss, do I have your consent to kiss you? Our clown world legal system is ready and willing to string you up. Of course, you shouldn't be kissing people that don't want to be kissed. But the point here is that regular nonverbal communication is being made irrelevant by this sort of hypertextual, analytical, permission slip, get a legally binding contract and receipt for every interaction culture that we are now facilitating. It's a confusing and threatening world out there for young men. I'm acutely aware of this phenomenon. Young men are being turned away from talking to women and forming romantic relationships, partially due to the fear of legal destruction that can occur via malicious prosecution, and are instead turning to hobbies like video games and comics to fill their time. I saw this take on Twitter that I actually really agreed with. Quote, "The time to investigate any allegations made by Christine Blasey Ford was 35 years ago, and the people to do it were the police. A he said, she said about something that may or may not have happened 35 years ago is ridiculous and shouldn't be treated seriously." End quote. There are other angles to this too. Her supposed witness, another man who went to school with Kavanaugh, adamantly denies the allegations. Again, not good news for her story. I've also seen rumors on Twitter that Ford's brother worked for Fusion GPS, the firm behind the anti-Trump dossier that now serves as the basis for the Mueller investigation. This actually isn't technically true. Ford's brother worked as a lawyer for Baker & Hostetler, a law firm that did business with Fusion GPS. Perhaps an interesting connection, but I don't really know if there's anything there. Baker & Hostetler employ thousands of attorneys. Anyways, why now? And why these tactics? Why the full court press over a judicial nominee that is still, despite the scandal, almost guaranteed to be confirmed? There are a few reasons. Reason number one is simple. Trump derangement syndrome. To many on the left, Trump is evil incarnate, and anyone he nominates, supports, endorses, or simply speaks nicely of is, by association, spawn of the devil. But Kavanaugh's case is also special. He's due to be confirmed to the court just a month before the midterm elections. The Democrats need a win going into November if they're going to be in any position to deliver on this supposed blue wave we are apparently going to see crashing down this fall. They know the numbers aren't looking good for them right now. They know they won't be winning the Senate, and probably won't take the House either. They need a big win, a catalyzing moment, in order to energize their supporters and compel their base to head to the polls. So far, they haven't found anything. Stormy Daniels, total fail. Michael Cohen, nothing there. Mueller probe, looking pretty dead in the water. They're setting their sights on stopping Kavanaugh's nomination, and having that be their big victory that pulls people out of their seats and out to the ballot box. It will be disheartening for them then, when they fail and Kavanaugh is eventually confirmed. He's expected to go before the Judiciary Committee for a vote on the 20th and the full Senate shortly after that. As I said before, the fact that we're allowing he said, she said cases from nearly 40 years ago to influence a judicial nomination just shows that we are no longer a serious country. The left will, of course, run with this accusation and use it to insist that Kavanaugh is an evil, scary sexual predator, despite a total lack of evidence. If this country is going to work, if our government is going to work, we need to judge nominees and candidates based on their merits or lack thereof. Not decide our leadership based on which side of the aisle can make the most salacious accusations of sexual misconduct, often without proof.